Good morning. Together. Oh, Heavenly Father, we are happy to be in your house, Lord. And we have all this celebration going on, and we are thinking of you, especially on this Palm Sunday when you entered into the city of Jerusalem. And it's such a long time ago, Lord, but we are still celebrating that today. And although we know what comes, the crucifixion, and later on this week, but then again next Sunday on Easter when you rise again, we're so excited, Lord, for this whole Holy Week and just for this family, your children gathered here together, and we just want to praise you. And we're not amiss this morning to be thinking that everybody's coming in here with a light heart and no problems and no burdens. We know quite the opposite is true, because we know we have trouble in this world. But while we're here, Lord, we want to celebrate you, and we want to praise you and lift your name. And we know that you meet us, and then in return, you lift us up. And even though we might still walk out with some of those same struggles and challenges, they're a little lighter after we leave this place today, and we praise your name for it. Amen. You may be seated. I want to share this with you. It is Palm Sunday, and John 12, in verse 12 and 13, Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. The next day, the great crowd that had come to the festival heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and they went out to meet him, and they were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." So that's what today is all about. The day that he walked into the city or rode in on a donkey into the city, and they laid down their coats and the palm trees, they just did anything they could to set him apart and to let him know that he was the King of Israel that they had been waiting for. So we're going to do that this morning. We've already done it, and we're going to do it, and we've got some fantastic helpers who are going to stand up in their chairs back there, guys. Pastor Heather's group, boys and girls, if you'll stand, and just like we practice, you're going to make your way to that middle aisle, and you're going to come right up. Find your places on the platform. Okay. the kids lifting their voices to the Lord. Just love it.
Amen.
I'm going to invite you to stand. We've been talking so much in this last few weeks leading up to Easter about surrender. And today we're talking about surrender in another area. And this song just fits perfectly with the way things are, the message and what is going on today. So many times we feel like so worthless. We can't get it right. How in the world would God ever care about us? How does he love us? But you're hanging in there because he's not leaving you. He's not leaving you. He's hanging on to you. Seated. So we want to, we have our video again today?
Yeah.
Yeah, let's go ahead and we'll show our video about our folders on the outside aisles. I don't know where they are now. People fill them out ahead of time. But do we have that, Robin? Thank you.
Pastor Heather, and I'm excited to share with you this morning about something new that we're trying, and we need your help. If you notice in the pew that you're sitting in, there's a little folder that looks like this, and this folder is going to help us to track attendance and to also better welcome newcomers. What we want everyone in the congregation to do every Sunday is to whoever's sitting on the end near the folder to take it, and they're going to be the first one, and we want you to go ahead and fill this out with your name, phone number, and just there's some questions in there that we want you to answer. If you would prefer to do it digitally, you can just scan the QR code right here. Also, if you're joining us online, the QR code should be being made available to you, and you can go ahead and scan that, and then you will be able to fill out the information as well. What we want you to do, and we're hoping that you'll do, is even if you're a regular attender, you're a member of our church, that you'll still participate, and it helps make it be more comfortable for everyone. And you can just put in your name and information. After a couple weeks of doing that, if you want to just fill out your name, that's fine. You can go ahead and do that. And then go ahead and pass it to the next person all the way until it's passed toward the center aisle. We really want your help. We're excited to partner with you and to be able to do a better job reaching out to newcomers and also to check up on people that we haven't seen for a while. Anyway, thanks for your help. Have a great day.
All right. Good morning, everybody. So it's always nice to have folks visit in and watch their grandkids. And I heard somebody exclaim, "Oh, that looks just like so-and-so." And it's like, "Oh, it is so-and-so." And anyway, we're glad you're here. A couple announcements. So obviously Easter is coming up. So we are having two services on Easter Sunday morning, a 9 o'clock service and a 10:45 service. And I believe as it's working out now, we're going to have baptisms in both of those services. So if you... So 9 or 10:45. The 10:45 service is going to be kind of our standard service, so there'll be a full children's program and stuff like that. So 9 or 10:45, you pick. We are also, in order to get ready for Easter, we had a plan to do it on Saturday, but obviously it rained on Saturday, so we are having a work day here tomorrow at 9 o'clock. So if you come, that would be great. We were having a meeting here yesterday for something different, and somebody came for the work day, and we shoved them in our meeting and kept them in our meeting the whole time. So, I came here to work, not to be in a meeting. But anyway, so work day tomorrow. Also coming up, we are partnering with the park and Locust Street just over the thing. So if you can help, I think there's a sign-up sheet out in the back. You can help maybe watch a game but thank you all for your eggs. I don't know how many eggs that you guys filled, but we filled a lot of them. So thank you very much for that. So that's at 9 to 12. And also Women of Faith, Have Faith Tour is coming up. So if you're interested, see Diane Hager. I don't know if Diane's here, but or you can let the office know. We'll take care of that. Any other announcements? Okay. So we are finishing up our... series on transformation through surrender, and I think we got some slides. My first slide is black, so I don't know if it's up there or not. There we go. Transforming power of surrender. So we've had a. If you're not a part of the church, we have had these Lenten devotionals throughout Lent, which have been very good, and so those are ending on Wednesday of this week. So then I'm encouraging everybody, whether you're part of the church or not, to maybe take Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and then Sunday morning and just read through the passion narratives in the Gospels in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, where Jesus is tried and then sent to the cross, and then obviously the resurrection. But I think you'd be encouraged by reading them, and if you haven't read them in a while, you might find some new insight and light. We just had our teens had a showing of the Passion of Christ here last night, I believe. So how'd that go?
Amazing.
If you haven't seen the Passion of Christ, it's a completely moving. And okay. So I think sometimes in church we take it for granted what Jesus has done for us. And to see it portrayed so vividly is really an incredible reminder. So this week we're talking about surrendering our failure. And it's the last sermon series in this series. And so it is what it is. I'm just going to jump into it. It's a story about King David. And if you're familiar with King David at all, his life starts out rather simply. He's a shepherd boy, and a prophet is told that a king is going to come out of his family, and his father gets all of his sons together, except David. He knows David isn't the one, so he brings all the other ones together, and none of those are the one, and the prophet asks, is there another one? And yes, but, you know, and so they bring, and it ends up being David. So King David is the one that fought Goliath and won, did all these different things. But he was also the king who committed adultery with Bathsheba. And then in order to cover up the adultery, he actually murdered then her husband. And so this is a story later in his life, but it's interesting, again, where we find David. And so let's kind of look at the story and think about our own story. It's found in 1 Chronicles chapter 21. So I'm going to read just bits and pieces of it so you can get the idea. But David, who is king, tells Joab, who is his general, to go and count the Israelites from Beersheba to Dan. So it's like from bottom of the country to the top of the country. And then report back to me so that I may know how many there are. Now, again, for us, you might read that if you're not real, real familiar with the Bible, or maybe even if you are, you'd think, okay, it just is what it is. But Joab's response is very interesting, and he says this, "Why does my Lord want to do this? Why should you bring guilt on Israel?" So Joab, his general, is saying, "King, you don't want to do this." Now, Joab was not a real paragon of virtue. So it's not like he was the goody two-shoes of the group, but he told the king very boldly, why should you bring this guilt on Israel? And then it says, the king's word, however, overruled Joab. So Joab left and went throughout Israel and then came back to Jerusalem with his report. It's interesting because then this describes Joab's response. So Joab brings back the numbers. But then it says, but Joab did not include Levi and Benjamin in the numbering. So he left out some of the tribes. It says, because the king's command was so repulsive to him. It's like, okay, I'm going to do it, but I'm not really going to do it. I'm going to count them, and then I'm only going to give you a portion of them, because he was so repulsed by the command. And then it says, this command was also evil in the sight of God, so he punished Israel. Well, how did he punish Israel? Well, so this happens. David orders this census to be taken. Joab says he shouldn't do it. I'm sure any of his leaders would have told him the same thing. But he does it, and then his prophet, or the prophet, comes and says, well, before this, he says, David, after David does it, he says, I have sinned by doing this. And now I beg you, God, to take away the guilt of your servant. I have done a very foolish thing. So he knew he shouldn't do it. He wanted to do it. There's speculation on why he did it. But as soon as he does it, he realizes, you know what? I have done a very foolish thing. And then it says, the Lord said to Gad, David's seer, go and tell David, this is what the Lord says. I am giving you three options. Choose one of them for me to carry out against you. So David knows he has done something foolish. So now the prophet is going to him and he says, you know what? God is giving you three choices. And here are the three choices. You can experience famine for 3 years. You can experience the sword of your enemy for 3 months. Or you can experience a plague at God's hand for 3 days. And so David calculates and says, I am in deep distress. Let me fall into the hands of the Lord, for his mercy is very great, but do not let me fall into human hands. So it's like none of these choices are good, but I'm going to commit myself to God's mercy and see what happens. And so then it says this, so the Lord sent a plague on Israel, and 70,000 men of Israel fell dead. It's pretty significant consequences when you think about it. So here is David. Joab tells him, don't do it. Don't do it. Why would you do it? And David said, do it. I'm the king. Do it. And he does it. He does it and he realizes, oh, I was wrong. But then God, and then 70,000 people fall dead. And then as this is happening, or after this has happened, David sees an angel of the Lord standing between heaven and earth with a sword, with a drawn sword in his hand extended over Jerusalem. So 70,000 people have already died. Now here's the angel. He's seeing the angel. I don't know exactly how that worked. But he sees the angel with his drawn sword extended over Jerusalem. So now he knows destruction is going to come on Jerusalem, his city. And then now this is the response of David. So Gad came to him and says, you have some options. He picked one. You know, he wanted to fall on the mercy of the Lord. But now he's at a completely different place. 70,000 people have died. And now Jerusalem is going to be at the sword of the angel. And David says this, was it not I who ordered the fighting men to be counted? I, the shepherd, have sinned and done wrong. These are but sheep. What have they done? So David has now really come to a very, very different place. And he says to the Lord, Lord my God, let your hand fall on me and my family. It's interesting he didn't say that at the beginning. But he does say it now at the end when he realizes all of the devastation caused by his consequences, by his sin. Do not let this plague remain on your people. And then it says, then the angel of the Lord ordered Gad to tell David to go up and build an altar to the Lord on the threshing floor of Arona. That's funny. I looked this up several times. Arona, I think is how you pronounce it. So, okay, I don't want any other pronunciations. By the way, I know who that was. Okay? So... But anyway, so here is David, and all of this has happened, and he's made this choice. He knows it's wrong. And he says, I, the shepherd, have sinned and done wrong. So I want to talk today about sin. And if you happen to be visiting today, you say, oh, of all days to visit, sin. Who likes to talk about sin? Well, nobody really likes to talk about sin. Sin is an uncomfortable topic. One reason we find sin problematic is that we can't seem to agree on what it is. And since sin is a matter of the heart, we don't always see when it is happening. You know, we could put on a really good face as far as sin is and what we're doing and those kind of things. But God really sees the heart and what's going on. Now, one of the puzzling questions when you look at this story is, why did David sin when he ordered a census to be taken? Now, you might be thinking, that wasn't a question for me. Well, that was a question for me as I read it. And there's different ideas of why this was a sin. But to me, that's not the primary issue here. So I want to ask you, have you ever gotten into an argument with someone over what is sin or what isn't sin? Or is it right to do that or isn't right to do that? I know I grew up in a church that had a lot of rules regarding behavior. Length of hair, earring, I can still remember my cousin got an earring. His parents said, all right, if you want it. First time he was going to meet my grandpa, took his earring out. His dad said, no, put that earring back in. You wanted that earring, you put it back in. Of course, an earring now is nothing. But then it was a big thing. But you had all these different things that you could and couldn't do, things that were sinful and not sinful. And then they seemed to change over time. So sin is just this interesting thing. But we talked, I think it was last week, about this idea that when God made this covenant with Israel, he says, listen, I am setting before you today life and death, blessing and curses. Welcome back, by the way. Haven't seen so-and-so for a long time. Man, encouraged. Anyway, but I'm also lost now. Blessings and curses. And so he says, choose life. I am telling you what life is. Choose it. Now, I'm giving you the option to choose, but why choose death when you can choose life? But like Israel, like David, like us, sometimes we choose things that are not right. So the important point of this story is, well, what was exactly the reason that the census was wrong? The important point in this story is about what sin was. It's not about what sin was, but that the parties involved knew that it was a sin. So it isn't so much, well, why is this so bad? But David knew it was bad. Joab knew it was bad. And then David did it anyway. As I was thinking about this, this verse came to my mind. Think about this. If anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin for them. I've told this story before, but some of you are new, so I'll tell it again. And but I had a particular opportunity in my life where I was so fired up for the Lord. I mean, I loved God. I was trying to witness to my friends. I invited this girl to come to church. I didn't think she would. She kind of was kind of hard, kind of harsh, but she came to church with me. And at the end of the service, the pastor was given an invitation for people to come accept Christ as their Savior. And this is so burnt into my mind. But so he's given this invitation, and I don't know if people were coming or not, but I could tell the girl next to me was a little uncomfortable. And then the pastor began to say, there's somebody out there that really wants to come but's afraid to come. And I thought, oh, he's describing this girl. And then he starts saying, there's somebody out there who's standing next to somebody who needs to come, and they're afraid, and they need to ask. And so now that I'm a preacher, he could have just been looking at me, you know what I mean, and describing the situation, because that is essentially what he was doing. I mean, he was just describing everything that was going on in my little world in my corner of the pew. And then the thing that I really remember, he said, he mentioned crying. And this girl was crying. So now that I'm thinking about it, I think he was watching us. I thought it was just God doing that. But I could not ask that girl to go forward. And you think, oh, it's not that big a deal. And so like David, I was like, I have sinned. I have done the wrong thing. And so the next day at school, I approached the girl and I said, hey, I should have asked you to go to the altar Sunday, but I was afraid. But, you know, you don't have to be in church to give your heart to the Lord. And she said, I so badly wanted you to ask me to go to the altar. And if you would have asked, I would have went. And I said, well, we can pray right here. And she's like, No, I don't think so. I'm not ready. I can't remember what she said, but it was like, that time has passed or something like that. And so this is very, you know, one of the things with this, it's even just like this, even for maybe some of you, if you've ever thought, you know what, maybe in this moment, in this time, I should share a little bit about the Lord, or I should share a little bit about my personal relationship with God. And then you think, no, I don't want to make it uncomfortable. I don't, I'm just, But I just want to say, with this idea of sin and the consequences of sin, we just don't always get to decide what they are or how monumental that they are. When it comes to sin, here is the way we do it. And I'm just talking to us like we're all the same kind of person, because we all are. When it comes to sin, again, this thing we don't like to talk about, when we do think about it, we tend to justify or compare, compare to so-and-so. Or we rationalize, well, the reason I did this is because I was afraid anybody would be afraid. Or we hide our sin, which is what so many of us do. Now, it's interesting, as I wrote this next sentence, the story is disconcerting because God's response to David's sin is so consequential. And I thought, Larry, that's a horrible sentence. You're not writing a paper. You're not trying to impress anybody. So I thought, well, what's a word that disconcerting? Then the computer told me distressing. I thought, I don't know if that's a whole lot better. But it's a little better. Nobody says disconcerting. So I put distressing in there. And then I thought, well, what can I do for consequential? And then I looked up a word that meant consequential, but all the other words were big. And so here's what it tells me is this. David knew not to sin. Joab reminded him it was a sin. But he sinned anyway. Now, the consequences of David's action, 70,000 men. And then he's looking at the angel, and then he's thinking about Jerusalem. Now he's completely broken. And so for all of us, I just want us to recognize that sin, even though we don't like to talk about it, is certainly an issue for us. Things that God has spoken to us about doing or not doing, and we make a decision. And sometimes we think, well, the consequences are not that significant. But we so often don't know. Do you think for a moment, if David really thought, this means 70,000 people are dying, that he would have done it? I doubt very seriously that he would have. But we don't get to look at things that way. So again, sin is uncomfortable to talk about, but we need to talk about it because the consequences of it are so significant. But the thing that is good is that God gives us His Word. It's just like Moses and the people of Israel. Listen, God is setting this before you today. Choose life or choose death. Choose blessing, not curses. And so He gives us His Word. And so one of the things that I said last week is, listen, you need to understand what God's will is. And it's interesting because our memory verse from the very beginning of this series was this idea of, if we'll offer our bodies as a living sacrifice, then we'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. And it is important that we know it and we walk in it. And by the way, you can walk through life and live and go to work and save for retirement and do all these things and not really care a whole lot about sin or how you're even living as far as God's concerned. You can do that. But it does not mean that there will not be consequences for you or your family or even people that you know. So God gives us His Word. He gives us His Spirit. And He gives us the family of God so that we can walk in His will. I don't think we take advantage of being in the church enough. I don't know that our relationships are significant enough so that we can be the Joab to David. Ken, why are you doing this? Well, half the time I don't even know what Ken's doing. And again, I can't know everybody's business. I don't need to know everybody's business. But I think part of the idea of the church is that we're there to help one another. And by the way, sin is significant. Now, everything changes for David. He drops all of his pretense when he sees the angel about to destroy Jerusalem. He is a sinner. And so he's thinking, why should I get to watch people being destroyed when I am the guilty party? And so David really realizes, again, I think in a way that for so many of us, we don't get to realize. So let me ask you this question. This is an interesting slide. Hopefully it gets you to think a little bit. Have you ever had that kind of revelation? Have you ever sinned in such a way that you were just devastated by it? Let me just say this. I have. I can remember crying on the words of Psalm 51 so much. I can't think of what Psalm 51 says now. Yeah, but what's the first part of it? Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. And then he just talks about the sin that he committed, and I thought, that is me. And I can still remember the pages of my Bible just welling up because I was just crying on it so much. Sin is significant. All sin doesn't have the same kinds of consequences, at least that we can see. But God is not arbitrary with how he describes or tells us to live our lives or that kind of things. It's just like a parent doesn't say, don't play in the road because we just are wanting to wreck our kids' lives. So here's the thought. I wouldn't be surprised. I love to write slides. And then later I think, oh, what in the world? Well, here's what I just wrote this. I wouldn't be surprised if some pretty significant sin has been perpetrated by people in this room. I think I should be like a television writer or something. I just thought, I like that. Even though you're all so good and you look so good. But the older I get, the more confident I am that there's some pretty dark stuff that lies in our past. But I put parentheses around pretty significant because what does that mean? A sin that might seem insignificant might have more consequences than you would ever dream. But we tend to put our sins on these things. Well, this is really bad. And still we do them. But sin in general, no matter how we value it, is significant. And we've got to be careful about it. I have a feeling, no, I know, not unlike David, you have known something to be wrong, a sin, and you've done it anyway. Even before you really know God in a significant way, God's Holy Spirit often says, don't do that, don't go there. Don't say that, don't act that way. But we do it anyway. Now we have some interesting options when it comes to sin. We can hide our sin. We can deny our sin. And I think this is a big one. This sin in our life, this darkness, that we would pay any amount of money if we could make it go away. We just bury it. And we hope it never resurfaces. We hope we never have to deal with it again. We just want to bury it. But sin, for whatever reason, does not want to stay buried. So it's a terrible long-term strategy. But we try to hide our sin, we deny our sin, and sometimes we think, you know what? Why should God be the arbiter of good and evil? I'll decide what is good and evil. I was talking with somebody the other day, and I think the thing that's interesting about people is even in our own thinking, this is right, this is wrong, we still do what is wrong, even by our own value system. So we can do all those things, or we can, like David, that the whole thing didn't need to happen in the first place, or we can be like David and we can repent of our sin. David is brought face to face with the consequences of his sin. Some might argue that God didn't have to punish Israel for David's sin. He could have just maybe killed David and his family to start with and let the nation remain unscathed. There's all kinds of questions that just revolve around this. But again, for so many of us, it's not those things that matter. It's not those big, real big picture things of why does this happen and why does God always respond. It was the thing that matters is that David knew that this was wrong. Joab reminded him that it was wrong, and he did it anyway. And again, like David's sin, hugely consequential. Now, our sins aren't all that way, but I tell you, I'm sure of this, that sometimes our sins are hugely consequential in our life. Infidelity, that's a huge one. All kinds of things, options in our life that we have, the consequences can be huge. So the Lord orders David, he orders Gad, go to David and say, I want you to build an altar on the threshing floor. And then it says, so David went up in obedience to the word that Gad had spoken in the name of the Lord. So we've been talking about these altars, these altar moments. And so here is David. He's gone through all this. He knew it was wrong, but he sins anyway. He repents, and he says, you know what, God, this is really my issue. Another thing we like to do with sin, we like to blame it on other people. You know, it's so-and-so's fault, so-and-so's fault. But David makes this altar, and he offers sacrifices on it. And we have been talking about this. The altar, as you see it in the Old Testament, was often this space that was created to bring an offering as a way to honor God and to encounter his presence. So you can imagine this moment in David's life. He knows so much better, but he still sins anyways. And 70,000 people die as a result of his sin. So God tells him, but he creates this altar, just as, you know, if it wasn't one thing, if it wasn't only one thing, but this one thing it was for sure, it was this reminder of the devastating effects of sin in our life. In the New Testament, so all of our stories have been in the Old Testament, but in the New Testament, Jesus becomes this space, this place where we can connect with God. It was through Jesus, the Son of God, that people were able to encounter the power and presence of the Lord in a new way. Jesus was the place for people who were hurting, lost, and who longed to experience God. And I want to close with this. We are going to share in the Lord's Supper. You don't have to be a Nazarene to share in this supper. But I don't want you to feel pressured to share in the Lord's Supper either. You may be from a different religious tradition and you're just not comfortable. That's okay. But we are going to do that at the end of the message. But I want us to think about this idea of sin and the fact that it doesn't escape any of us. There's nobody in here that hasn't sinned. And again, even the idea of if people could really know our hearts, not just our actions, but the thoughts of our heart. So as we think about Jesus and what he's done, and again, we're moving into Easter, and even as we think about Palm Sunday where people were, Jesus, and next thing they were saying was crucify him. So fickle we are. But here's this great truth, this idea that sin really does impact all of us. The writer of Hebrews says, we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses. But we have one. Now he's speaking about Jesus. But we have one who has been tempted in every way just as we are, yet he did not sin. So we have a high priest who gets us. And so he says this, because of this, let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Sin is a significant issue, and rather than hide it or bury it or whatever we decide to do, how much better to repent of it and be done with it? So a couple questions to think about as we kind of go into our time of sharing in the Lord's Supper. Have you addressed the sin in your life? Maybe you've just buried it. And maybe it feels mostly gone away. But then a sermon like this, it's like, oh, you bring it all back up again. But have you addressed the sin in your life? The answer might be absolutely. But again, for some of us, because we treat sin in all these different ways, maybe we just haven't. Some of you may still be struggling with sin that you have addressed. I get this. It's like this sin just haunts you. It follows you. You feel identified to it. It's just, even though you've asked Jesus to forgive you and that you know Jesus' blood atones for your sins, it just follows you like this gray, dark mass. You just can't seem to get rid of it. The sermon title today is about this idea of surrendering our failure, of not holding on to it anymore, of just leaving it where it should be, which is at God's feet. For you to create maybe an altar in your life and just lay that on there and say, I'm done with it. I'm done with it. But the truth is, for all of us, if we really understand Christ, now I'm thinking about just celebrating the Lord's Supper together, is that for all of us, even if maybe we just have this sense of, my sin has been forgiven, then this idea of we celebrate the Lord's Supper today is, God, thank you for what you have done for me in Christ Jesus. We don't have to carry, we use sin and guilt as a manipulative tool for us, you know. Giving somebody a guilt trip is pretty effective sometimes. But that's not what God wants to do with his guilt. He wants to convict us of it. He wants us to admit it, repent of it, and be done with it. God doesn't want to hold it over our head year after year after year after year. He wants his people to be able to say, I'm forgiven. I'm certainly not perfect, but I'm forgiven. But you cannot feel that if you have buried that thing deep and deep and deep into your life and think it's so bad I don't even want to begin to deal with it. I feel like God has so much more. And even this idea of just surrendering our life to God and say, you know what, God, I am tired of trying to be the arbiter of what is right and good. I want to follow you. But for some reason, we just think, I don't know, this God who sent his son to die on the cross for me, maybe he doesn't have my best interest at heart. Are you kidding me? If you sacrifice your kid for me, I wouldn't doubt for a minute your love for me. Nothing would validate it more. So God says, listen, I want you to know how much I love you. I'm willing to give my son for you. But even with all of that being said, so often it's hard for us to really fully surrender our life to God. He tells us that this is life, and we choose over here anyway. So sin is an issue that we all have to deal with. Now, hopefully you've been to that place where, again, that you're forgiven. But maybe this is the day for you. Maybe this is for you a day to build an altar and be done with it. Yeah, it might be awful. The consequences might be pretty significant. But God's plan is not that you pay the price day after day after day after day. So here's what we're going to do. I want to take a minute and pray for you. And we don't always do it this way, but Stephen Stiles is going to help me. Stephen, if you can kind of maybe make your way to the front. Is Stephen even in here? Oh, but is he coming? I'm going to pray for us, and then I think what I'm going to do is just have you, if you would like to share in communion, just come down the center aisle and then kind of go back to your chair. But if walking is an issue for you or whatever, Stephen is going to kind of serve you back there. But I want to pray for all of us before we take communion together. I think we need the praise team up, right? Praise team, would you mind coming on up? Let's take a minute and pray together. Father, nobody likes to talk about sin. And even for us, maybe even now, we think, have I paid enough for that sin? Can I really be free of it? Can I really be made new? Can I stop being defined by that sin? And so, Father, the story is just a way for us to begin to focus on the fact that our sin has separated us from you. And sometimes, like David, it has devastating consequences in our life. Some of us have made choices that we knew were wrong. We thought we could get away with it, but we didn't. And so we, Father, you know how we are. We just walk with this load of guilt day after day, week after week. But I pray today that instead of choosing that option, that we would acknowledge our sin, that we would repent of our sin, and that we would know that in Christ Jesus, we have this great high priest who understands us. We don't always even understand ourselves. So, Father, I don't know who's going to share in this communion meal together. But I pray that as people make their way to the front, that they would be, if there's issues that haven't been dealt with, that they would just give those to you. Like David, they would just confess. And Father, I pray that they would just understand that in Christ Jesus, they can be forgiven. The slate can be wiped clean. Father, for that person who just can't seem to shed this issue in their life, I pray somehow through the power of your Spirit, maybe today would be the day. I think about that verse that we didn't read where it says that you answered David by fire and burnt up the sacrifices. Father, maybe somehow if you could answer us with fire today, that you would just purify this stuff out of our life. We know it. We've confessed it. We've tried to deal with it, but it just lingers. Father, I pray that you'd set some people free today. But Father, behind or underneath everything, I pray that you would help us approach you today. I mean, Carrie and I are going to be standing here with the elements, but I pray that as we approach you today, we would come with a sense of celebration, knowing that the meal is offered to us not because we have earned it, but because you have loved us. You have forgiven us. We praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So let me just clarify. Again, you don't have to be a Nazarene. But, and maybe even today is the first day you've really dealt with sin, then you come on up. You know, but again, if you don't feel comfortable, you sit where you are. But Stephen is going to come. Stephen, why don't you? And I'll let you move toward the back before the crowd forms. Dear. All right, so if the praise team know how to sing without you. Okay. That was supposed to be funny. Don't take offense. Okay. All right. So they're gonna sing. If you would like to come, just again, come through the center aisle and then return to your seats. The communion supper instituted by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is a sacrament which proclaims his life, his sufferings, his sacrificial death, and his resurrection, and the hope of his coming again. The supper is a means of grace in which Christ is present by the Spirit. It is to be received in reverent appreciation and gratefulness for the work of Christ. All of those who are truly repentant, forsaking their sins, believing in Christ for salvation, are invited to participate in the death and resurrection of Christ. We have come now to his table that we may be renewed in life and salvation and may be one by the Spirit. I just want to say, I don't know that any communion service has been more meaningful than this one for me, for whatever reason. What a privilege to be sharing it with you. What a gift God's given us. So I want to confess as a church, I'm going to give you three phrases, and I think I'm going to give them to you trusting that we can say them all together. We're going to say first, Christ has died, then Christ is risen, and then Christ will come again. So let's say that together. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we gather at your table with thanksgiving in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who by your Spirit was anointed to preach good news to the poor, proclaim release to the captives, set at liberty those who are oppressed. Christ fed the sick, healed the sick, fed the hungry, ate with sinners, and established the new covenant for the forgiveness of sins. We live in hope of his coming again. And so we gather as a body of Christ to offer ourselves to you in praise and thanksgiving. Pour out your Spirit on us and on these your gifts. Make them by the power of your Spirit to be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one in Christ, one with each other, and one in the ministry of Christ to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now, if you'll join with me, the body of our Lord Jesus, broken for you, may it preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and be thankful. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, shed for you, preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and be thankful. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I think about this week for me. It was not a good week. And we have good weeks and we have bad weeks. But thank you for your truth, your love, the gift of Christ that transcends all of that. Help us to walk in newness of life. Help us to be able to celebrate all that you have given us in Christ Jesus. And Father, as we have talked about today, help us to recognize the destructiveness of sin in our life. Help us as a body of believers to love and care for one another. Father, direct us as we read your word and as we listen to what it is that you have to say. Father, thank you for this opportunity. I feel so blessed today for some reason. You are so good and your mercy endures forever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Can we stand and sing that chorus together just in response to taking the Lord's Supper today? Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus, for your
thank you, Jesus. Gorgeous.
Thank you for singing.